You are listening to a Core Awareness Seminar by Liz Cook. Her website is www.coreawareness.com. That's C-O-R-E awareness.com. Please note that Core Awareness is a trademark signature of Liz Cook, her workshops, seminars, books, and CDs. The information presented in the seminar is in no way intended as a substitute for receiving professional medical care. The design and purpose of the seminar is to provide information and to simply educate. The author and publisher shall have neither liability nor responsibility to any person or entity with respect to any loss, damage, or injury caused or alleged to be caused directly or indirectly by the information, suggestions, explorations, or exercises contained within the seminar or written in response to the seminar. The author is not a medical authority, and she is not qualified to diagnose or prescribe any therapy. The information is simply her personal opinion. Please seek medical care for whatever condition you may have. The Psoas and Back Pain, Chapter 1, Meet Your Psoas. Hi, I'm the author of the Psoas book and Core Awareness, Enhancing Yoga, Pilates, Exercise, and Dance, and Unraveling Scoliosis CD. I'm a somatic educator, and I teach workshops around the world, specifically about the psoas muscle. I created this CD to help you understand the connection between the psoas and low back pain, tension, and any kind of discomfort you might be feeling. Whether chronic discomfort or a specific injury, your psoas muscle will be part of it. So knowing about it is so important. So let's begin with the name psoas. It's spelled P-S-O-A-S, and the P is silent. So psoas is how you pronounce it. Iliopsoas is its full name, and it affects all aspects of your spinal health. This 60-minute CD is going to help you understand your psoas and how it plays a part in your health, in your movement, and in your overall comfort. The psoas is your core muscle. So what does that mean? It means that it's literally in your core. It's behind those abdominal muscles, deep within the center of your being. So let's describe how to find it. If you place your hands on your ribs, the last rib, at the bottom of your sternum, and you follow those ribs around to the back, you'll come to a vertebrae that's called your 12th thoracic vertebrae. That's approximately where your psoas begins. It moves through your core, one on each side, over the hip sockets, to the lesser trochanter. Your hip sockets you find by placing your fingers on your navel and spreading your hands across to the outside of your pelvis. Those are your iliac crests, those kind of high points of your pelvis. From there, you're going to angle at a triangular angle to your pubis bone. And go slowly, don't press. But as you move your hand across your belly, your finger may fall into a kind of little hollow area. That's where your hip sockets are. They're actually on the front of your pelvis, not on the sides. The bone you feel on the side of your pelvis, that we call the greater trochanter. If you place your finger there, you can find your lesser trochanter by imagining a line directly across the thigh to the inner groin of your leg. I recommend looking at an anatomy book or Googling the psoas to see some images of what the psoas looks like. Your iliopsoas is the only muscle that attaches your spine to your leg. This is so important, I'm going to say it again. Your iliopsoas is the only muscle attaching spine to leg. What the psoas does is it allows free swing of the leg in walking. It's a fluid motion from heart and core to toe, transferring weight and expression. I think very differently about the psoas than most anatomy books. I don't think of it as just a muscle. First of all, it's the filet mignon, which means it's the most juicy, supple tissue. Delicious in other animals. And in you, hopefully it's juicy and supple as well. So you don't want a tight, dry, dysfunctional psoas. You don't want it compensating, because when it compensates for long periods of time, it becomes misused. That's the major part of its relationship to back pain, is misuse. Now, iliopsoas and psoas can be interchangeable, and I may speak about both, but they're actually two muscles. There's the psoas, which is a multi-joint muscle beginning at T12, thoracic vertebrae. It's behind the diaphragm, and it attaches to each of the lumbar vertebrae. Now, each of the places that the psoas grows out of the spine, what we call attachments, but no one attached the muscle, it grew out of the spine. Each of these places is a place where the psoas can contract or release, respond to the spine. Then it moves over the hip socket, and in a triangular shape, it attaches to the lesser trochanter. And there's the iliacus muscle. And the iliacus muscle is a fan-shaped muscle. It has an intimate relationship with the psoas muscle. It shares a common tendon. It moves up and opens to embody the entire pelvic basin. The pelvic basin is a bowl-like structure, and the iliacus, like a fan, lines the inside of your pelvis. What happens in the iliacus affects the psoas. What happens in the psoas influences the iliacus. The iliopsoas has a very intimate relationship with your spine, and that's why it's so important when you're solving low back problems. But I'd like to reframe how I think about the psoas muscle. You can read a lot about the biomechanical view of the psoas, but I believe that the iliopsoas is a biointelligent smart tissue. It's a messenger of the central nervous system. And by shifting the language, biomechanical language, to a wider, broader, biointelligent language, we give hope to resolving low back issues. When you think of the biointelligent psoas, we're looking at tissue, we're looking at cells that are constantly recreating themselves. So no matter what's going on in your spine, no matter what's going on in your psoas, no matter what's going on in your core, there is the capacity for your body to heal. The resiliency, the responsiveness is always available. So it gives hope to resolving low back issues. I know for myself, I had low back issues for many years as a young woman. And now I have none of those. 40, 50 years later, I have a resilient, responsive spine. So bodies change. Bodies have the capacity to heal when we work within this biointelligent framework. We're going to start with looking at the functions of the psoas, and that's in Chapter 2.